Shalom to you, family, in Messiah Yahushua, and welcome to anyone truly seeking for truth from the Creator and Heavenly Father, Yahuwah. Peace and Barukah, or blessings, with favor be multiplied unto you in the name of HaMashiach Yahushua. It is a great joy to report that the name of our Master, the Messiah, Yahushua, is traveling the world over, seeking out the lost sheep of the house of Yasharel. Ephraim has awoken. The tribes are standing up for truth, for Yahuwah. For our study today, let us begin with a very relevant warning of scriptural truth from Kazun, or Revelation, chapter 14, beginning with verse 9. And a third messenger followed them, saying with a loud voice, If anyone worships the beast and his image, and receives his mark in his forehead or in his hand, he also shall drink of the wine of the wrath of Elohim, which is poured out undiluted into the cup of his wrath. And he shall be tortured with fire and sulfur before the set-apart messengers and before the Lamb. And the smoke of their torture goes up forever and ever, and they have no rest, day or night. Those worshipping the beast and his image. Also, if anyone receives the mark of his name. This warning is relevant for today, just as it was 1900 years ago, or 1000 years ago, or even 100 years ago. Please remember that Yahuchanan, the Talmidim, or disciple, that Yahushua loved, received the revelation vision roughly 1,923 years ago, in about the pagan year 90 AD. This specific part of the vision, this warning was that if anyone worships the beast in his image, and receives his mark in his forehead or in his hand, he shall drink of the wine of the wrath of Yahuwah, and then also be tortured with fire and sulfur before the Kadosh messengers and before the Lamb. The smoke of their torture goes up forever and ever. They have no rest day or night. Those worshipping the beast and his image. Also, if anyone receives the mark of his name. We have a few questions arise from this segment of Scripture that are going to be answered now. The first being, where would anyone be tortured with fire, that the smoke of their torture goes up forever and ever? Revelation chapter 20 and verse 15 states, And if anyone was not found in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. If your answer to our first question was the lake of fire, you were absolutely correct. The next questions, which all flow together, for it is the same spirit of anti-Messiah that works through them, is, What is the beast? What is his image? What is the mark of the beast? Let's review Revelation chapter 13. And I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast coming up out of the sea, having seven heads and 10 horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his heads names of blasphemy. And the beast I saw was like a leopard, and his feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power, and his throne, and great authority. And I saw one of his heads as having been slain to death, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the earth marveled after the beast, and they worshipped the dragon, who gave authority to the beast. And they worshipped the beast, saying, Who is like the beast? Who is able to fight with him? And he was given a mouth, speaking great matters and blasphemies, and he was given authority to do so 42 months. And he opened his mouth in blasphemies against Elohim, to blaspheme his name and his tent and those dwelling in the heaven. And it was given to him to fight with the Kadosh ones and to overcome them. And authority was given to him over every tribe and tongue and nation. And all those dwelling on the earth whose names have not been written in the book of life of the slain Lamb from the foundation of the world shall worship him. If anyone has an ear, let him hear. He who brings into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with the sword has to be killed with the sword. Here is the endurance of the Kadoshim. And I saw another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had 2 horns like a lamb, and spoke like a dragon. And he exercises all the authority of the first beast in his presence, and causes the earth and those who dwell in it to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he does great signs, so that he even makes fire come down from the heaven on the earth before men. And he leads astray those dwelling on the earth because of those signs which he was given to do before the beast, saying to those dwelling on the earth to make an image to the beast, who was wounded by the sword, yet lived. And there was given to him to give spirit to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause to be killed as many as would not worship the image of the beast. And he causes all, both small and great, and rich and poor, and free and slave, to be given a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads. And that no one should be able to buy or sell, except he that has the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Here is the wisdom. He who has understanding, let him calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. Now think about this, brothers and sisters, this position of man, this head of the spirit of anti-Mashiach, the visible head of mankind being led by the powers and principalities of darkness. This is the head of the kingdom of darkness, the kingdom of Babylon. This man and his position, this king of Babylon, represents and is represented by an image, an idol, the present day abomination of desolation, the image to the beast. This is the lie. This is what has been given power and authority from HaShaitan to be worshipped by all those whose names are not in the Lamb's Book of Life. This is the oldest version of the Book of Revelation, chapter 13 and verse 18. The short portion there with the red underline or underscore is the mark of the beast. This is from the Chester Beatty P47, which is dated to the 3rd century, which is from 280 to 299 AD. It is the oldest or earliest known manuscript or copy of this portion of the Book of Revelation that we have publicly. I do understand that perhaps in the Vatican secret libraries or somewhere else on the earth there may be something older. There may even be something in Abri or Hebrew. That is our hopes anyway, that something like that turns up, something even more accurate at this point. We are working with what we have. This, in the Greek, is the mark of the beast. It said 666, however, in the oldest Greek version that we have available publicly to study from, the P47 from the Chester Beatty Library, it's a name which is comprised of the Greek letters Chi, Xi, and a cursive digamma. The Chi and the Xi are easy to determine. Just do a little bit of research and you will find them, and you will find that their numerical values come to 660. For the last one, the digamma, the numerical value of it is 6. So there's your 666. In this olden extant copy or manuscript that we have for this three-letter numerical value of 666, this last number character, the digamma. The top loop of the digamma tends to be somewhat larger and extends further to the right than that of the final sigma. It's pretty easy to get these two confused, the digamma and the final sigma, because in later usage the digamma grew a tail like the final sigma, as you can see in these two examples, the final sigma and the digamma. Both have tails. And by tail, I mean that the bottom curls back underneath, sort of forming a letter S, or even an upside down S, so to speak. But the earliest version that we have, the P47, is simply just a curl there, like a C, but the top report of the C extends further. So we can see why so many people in figuring this have determined that it was a final sigma or a lunate sigma. I myself was guilty of this, in that the two look so very similar, but on closer inspection, further study, we see that this last of the three characters is not a final sigma. It is surely a digamma. We go to the oldest source that we have on the matter, the P-47, and we cross-check that. Let's take a look. The Codex Vaticanus, for example, dated to about 350 AD. Yes, it also has the Dagamma. But of course, we don't trust anything that comes out of the Vatican. Let's check that with a more reliable source. So thus we have the P-115 dated to about 225 to 275 AD. And yes, again, the last of the three characters is a Dagamma. The Dagamma, anciently, makes the sound, the same exact and similar sound as the Abri or Hebrew letter Wa. That's right, the Wa, or the double U as we look at it in English. The Dagamma, like its model, the Phoenician Wa, it represented the voiced labial velar approximant W, or Wa, and stood in the sixth position in the alphabet, between Epsilon and Zeta, this of course in the Greek. It is the consonantal doublet, or double version, of the vowel letter Upsilon, the Greek U, which was also derived from Wa, but was placed at the end of the Greek alphabet. So if you understood what was just spoken, both the Greek U and the Greek W, or the Dagamma, came from the Phoenician Wa. This is ancient Greek. So for those who try to argue that the modern common transliteration of the Hebrew Wa and the English W comes from some Germanic Vav form, they're wrong. They're dead wrong. There was a Wa in the ancient Greek, which came from the Phoenician, which is very much interchangeable with the pure and perfect Abri, the Phoenician language, and the pure and perfect Abri are very, very similar, if not brother-sister languages, much like Hebrew and Arabic. Many of the sounds of the letters in Arabic are very similar, if not the same, as the ancient Abri. You have to remember where those people came from, the Arabic people, most of them partaking in Islam today. They came from none other than the brother of the promise. That's right. The rejected son, Ishmael, of whom came those of the flesh, those descendants, those Palestinians, so to speak. They were not the heirs of the promise. And so the pure language, the brotherly language, the right language, stayed with Yahuwah's people all the way down through the Exodus. This Paleo-Abri script then stayed with the Hebrews, the people of Yahuwah, all the way down through the time of the prophets and King David, as well as into the, more modern, roughly about 2,000 years ago, Greek that still had the name as shown here in the Paleo-Hebrew, the name of the Father, Yahuwah. They were showing him honor and respect by not trying to write it in a pagan tongue, but writing it in the very language and signature that he would have used. During King Dawood's time, David, and through archaeological study, supposedly, this Paleo-Hebrew, as it's being called more and more today, is most likely what the script was of the ancient Abri when King David walked the earth. It's a wa. And we know this simply from the words hallelujah and Yahuda. It's not a vav, it doesn't make a V sound, it makes a W sound. Or a vowel consonant UW sound, proven through different languages. And guess who is the master, creator, and author of all the languages on this planet? That's right, Yahuwah, when he confused the languages at the Tower of Babel. So going back to this three-letter character numerical value of 666, we sound these out, the chi, the xi, and the digamma, and it makes this sound. Kiasu. Kiasu. Very, very, very interesting. The name that the Latin-speaking Roman Catholic beast has been using, along with all those who have been denying the truth of Yahushua, Yahuwah is salvation, Yahuwah has delivered, and all those, even of the secular world, the secular mindset, all of them being compromised, partaking in that same spirit of anti-Mashiach, calling him, the son of Yahuwah, a name of blasphemy, the lie. The name of blasphemy is pronounced almost identically. Kiasus, Kiasu. In Greek, we're used to seeing it written, Iasus. In Arabic, Isu, Isu. In Hebrew, in modern Hebrew, Yeshu. Yeshu. The Latin, which was the mother language for English, or Old English, and then eventually, like in the King James Version, 1611, King James Version, we get the I on the beginning, the representative I, which came from the ki, or the chi, in the ancient Greek. The Latin to the English gets that I becoming a J. Jesu and Jesus. No joke. We're talking about the mark of the beast. We're talking about the name, the personification, the numerical value, the image to the beast, that the majority of the people on this planet profess for the name of the Messiah. Whether they're active Christians or not. Whether they're in Hollywood and just reading a script for a movie. Whether they're just your average secular human on the street who doesn't go to a church. Or who doesn't read their Bible. Or in many, many different languages around the planet. People who have not been made Kiddush by Yahuwah. What do they call the Messiah? What do they know of for the name of the Messiah? And they will profess some version of this Kiasu. Iasus, Jesus, Jesu. Yeshu, Yesu. It is blasphemy. This is the mark of the beast. The Messiah's name are not any of these. The Messiah's name is Yahushua. Yahuwah has saved. Yahuwah is deliverance. Yahushua.
Yahushua.
Do you need further proof? Then just think about the militant arm of the beast of the Vatican, from its heart, from its head, the Jesuits. Jesu, come from the mark of the beast, Kiasu. If you listen to its head, if you listen to the white clown pronounce the name in the whore of Babylon's native tongue, which is Latin, he will say it and you will hear it. Kiasu or Kiasus. The mark of the beast. If you take just a little bit of time to study between the Yeshu acronym and the Yeshua that is popular amongst messianic circles, you'll find out that they are interchangeable. Even Judaism, even the rabbinic scribes of just in the last few hundred years and during the Dark Ages, they would interchange them. And they will even plainly state, if you look for it, those names are the same. They're false. Some people try to explain the Yeshua away in that, oh, it's a shortened version. And even the concordances will show that it leads back to Yahushua, this Yeshua. But what they've done there with that shortened version is they've gotten rid of the middle-length name of the Father, which the Father named the Son, Yahushua. So any person trying to change that name or thinking that they can shorten it is doing lawlessness and has done lawlessness. The Messiah's name is not Yahushua or Yeshua. And it certainly never was Yeshu, that satanic acronym. That satanic acronym which accurately translated and studied out does mean he, as in the Father, he will blot out his name. Do you really think Yahuwah is going to work to blot out his son's name? That is ridiculous nonsense. And it is blasphemy. Of course, nothing is hidden from Yahuwah. Let's take a look at Yirmiyahu chapter 11 and verse 19. But I was like a gentle lamb brought to the slaughter, and I did not know that they had plotted against me, saying, let us destroy the tree with its fruit, and let us cut him off from the land of the living, and let his name be remembered no more. There you have it. Prophecy through prophet of Yahuwah, the word of Yahuwah, concerning this matter of what they were going to do with his name. The Messiah came, his name was Yahushua, and they worked to blot out or remove his name, that it would not be remembered anymore. The wicked scribes of those of Yehuda and Babylon who dismissed him as being false, and yet they were the ones living dangerously, rejecting the truth, rejecting the word of Yahuwah, and their acronym, their satanic acronym of Yeshu. There's the proof in the word of Yahuwah. Yahuwah knew it was going to happen, and it did. Yeshu is blasphemy. Now listen up, Natsarim Kadashim, the elect of Yahuwah. Brothers and sisters, in the days that Messiah Yahushua walked the earth, in translating his name, Yahushua, from the Abri, from the Hebrew, into Latin, all the letters existed And this is how it would have looked. Yes, you can see it right there on the screen. Yahushua. It is the base language, the Latin, the base language for all the other Romantic languages, which is primarily where the common modern American English came from. The majority of it came from Latin, and as you can see, those are the letters. That is the script that most likely would have been used to transliterate the actual name of the Messiah. Very easy to read. It looks nearly identical. If you take a look at the line there, the second one down that says classical with the alphabet after it, the Latin alphabet, and you go all the way through the letters, they are all pretty much the same as the English ones except for the one for the U. It's actually a what we would consider a V. So there's your U. All the other letters exist, and if we just take a quick few seconds here and read the lines underneath the four descriptions, in the black it says the letters Y and Z were added for to write Greek's loan word, or in other words, to bring in loan words from the Greek language into the Latin, during the early imperial period or during the first century before Common Era. That's leading up into the time of Messiah Yahushua. That means every letter was accounted for to be able to properly transliterate from the Abri, from the Hebrew, the name of Yahushua into the Latin. That line up there that says it is the archaic Latin, that would have been before Messiah's time. The classical would have been during, would have been recently before and recently afterwards for quite a while, and especially during his time. This script that is very easy to read for us who are of who have learned English. Of course, also there in the red, the transliterated sounds that the Latin letters would have made or would make, and then the phonetics. How would it sound? Take a look. You can figure this out yourself. You can translate it. You can transliterate it yourself from Hebrew straight into Latin, or first into Greek, then into Latin, and then into English, and it's still going to sound like the proper noun that it is and most important name given under the heavens among men for salvation, for deliverance, to be saved, to be delivered. Yahushua. This information coming from ancientscripts.com, www.ancientscripts.com, just as it appears on the screen for your convenience. This information concerning that there was a Latin letter Y which would have perfectly transliterated the Hebrew Yah during the time of Messiah Yahushua and thereafter existed. This information can be found on multiple websites. You can ask Latin scholars. It is truth. You may be asking, what did the scribes do in the last 2,000 years to mess this up? Brothers and sisters, somewhere along the line, it was purposefully done by those working for the beast, those who were causing others to worship the dragon. Now take a look here. This is how the Messiah's name, in the time frame that he walked the earth, this is how it would have looked transliterated into Greek. It would have sounded a little bit more like Giasua, with the enunciation on the ia for the yod he, for the ya. Remember, this is Greek. Go ahead and go to Google Translate and try it yourself. Type in Yahushua without the W's in the English side. Translate it into Greek and then hit the little the noise or the speaker symbol there, circled there. And listen to it and listen to how it sounds. Speak to Latin scholars, people who know a little bit about Hebrew and Latin, and they'll tell you. This would be a truer transliteration than what the beast has been trying to sell us. Lies. The beast isn't teaching people this concerning transliterating the true name of the Messiah into Latin or Greek. But you're getting it here. Hallelujah, because of the will of Yahuwah. So as you can see, the name of the Messiah can be more rightly translated from the more pure Bri into Latin and Greek. And thus, in the English, we would have it as Yahushua. Just like that. This is where we must really scratch our heads. This is where we must wonder and go, what? What were they thinking? Why would they do such a satanic work? And that is the answer therein. They were working for HaShatan. They were working for Satan. The mark of the beast is a name, which represents an idol, who is perfectly represented by the head of the beast, the Roman Catholic pontiff, the white clown. But that is wrong. And that is sin, error.
The name, personification, and image of Jesus is
the mark of the beast.
Doesn't matter if it's white Jesus, or black Jesus, or tan Jesus, or large Jesus, or small Jesus, or wooden Jesus, or metal Jesus, or old Jesus, or young Jesus, or golden Jesus, or concrete Jesus, or happy Jesus, or scary Jesus. These are idols. 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 Idolatry. Remember what Yahuwah hates. Remember what Yahuwah has said. The first, second, and third commandment speaks against this. Have no other mighty ones before my face. Make no idols. Do not bow down to those idols. Do not take my name in vain. Repent of worshipping the beast. Repent of worshipping its image. Repent of worshipping the lie. Who is it more than any other institution on the face of this earth that has been taking the lie, the mark of the beast, to nearly every nation, tongue, people, to confuse them, to cause lawlessness, to invite them to worship the beast and worship the dragon? None other than that same military arm of the whore of Babylon, the Jesuits themselves, going as missionaries, being the heads of colleges, being the puppeteers of financial institutions, governments, militaries, the backbone, that is helping the whole world to worship the dragon. They haven't been taking the name of Yahushua to the four corners of the earth. Nope. They've been taking another name. And every daughter harlot, missionary system, Protestant churches sending forth their young people, old people alike, to do the work of the dragon, to do the work of HaShatan, working darkness, taking forth a name, an image, a false image of the Creator, one that does not save. Let us all profess the true testimony of the one and only Messiah, Yahushua. People can't even be saved without the name of the Messiah. His total and true character summed up the work that Yahuwah Al Shaddai did and does through his Son. Summed up in the name and the character. The character which is represented by the name. Yahushua. Yahuwah has delivered. Yahuwah has saved. Yahuwah be esteemed. The name, embodiment, and character of the Son is the embodiment of the Father. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He is the representative and manifest image, the word of Yahuwah, the image of Yahuwah, Yahushua. And Satan, as the imposter and liar that he is, has used the imposter, the substitute, the false image, the lie, to deceive people into worshiping him, the name, personification, and image of Jesus is the mark of the beast. In conclusion, we must ask ourselves this question. Should we be using this imposter name or any version of it, any different languages version of it for the name, for a name of the Messiah? No. No, we should not ever. It is sin. It is blasphemy. Yahushua, the true name of the Messiah, can be translated, can be transliterated into nearly every language on this planet, and it would sound nearly the exact same as the true and pure, perfect Hebrew language would pronounce it. Names have meaning, words have power. Think about this. Meditate upon this, brothers and sisters. Yahushua has a meaning. And also, the lie, Jesus, this name, also has a meaning. Are they the same? Is their root even the same? No. The excellent name of Yahushua describes a character attribute of the Father, what he is doing in us. The other, the imposter, it represents all lying power and authority of the dragon given to the beast. It is a lie. This is the authority that has allowed the beast to think, to change times and laws, to think that it has had such authority, but it did not get its authority from Yahuwah, it was given it from the dragon. This same lying authority that thought to change the true evening to evening, Shabbath, seventh day of Yahuwah, of rest, to the pagan Sunday, to name months by pagan idol names, to call Yahuwah by pagan idols' names, to substitute a blasphemous, mockery, acronym, name for the Messiah, to print Bibles with all these false names in them, and so on and so forth, to give us a false Babylonian, Roman, Julian, and Gregorian calendar system that doesn't honor the one who gave us time and seasons, the beast power that gave us these pagan celebrations and festivals and Christianized them, but they're still disgusting matters before Yahuwah, even as Yahuwah has shown you by showing you all the wickedness that exists in this world in the form of disobedience, comparing that, discerning that with the righteous will of Yahuwah in what he desires for us to do in obeying him and his word, his son, Yahushua Mashiach, and the word that has gone forth and been written upon your heart to keep his commands. Hallelujah! It's the Ruach HaKadosh of Yahuwah that leads us into all truth and gives us discernment by taking on the mind of Messiah Yahushua and conforming to his image, by being trained up by the excellent schoolmaster of the Torah of Yahuwah, the instructions, so that we may be able to spiritually discern all this evil lawlessness within the world today, and even within the pagan Christianity, or in Judaism, or Messianic Judaism, or Islam, all these forms of worship apart from Yahuwah that do not benefit mankind. They are worshiping the dragon. Every single form of worship that is not in the Emunah of Yahushua, keeping the commandments of Yahuwah. So we have the truth versus the lie. They are not interchangeable. The lie is not a sufficient substitute for the truth. On a closing note and key point of understanding, the Kai Zai Digama was not taken directly by the scribes and put in as a replacement name for the Messiah Yahushua. Please don't get me wrong. It was prophetic. The book of Revelation was prophetic to tell what would happen. And even near after, about 90 AD, when Yahuchanan, the Talmudim that Yahushua loved, received the vision on the island of Patmos, this pronunciation of the 666, this Kiesus pseudoname, this lie, this mark of the beast, those who were operating to do away with the true name of Yahushua replaced it, or replacing it with the moniker, the acronym of mockery, Yeshu, and then having that satanic mockery acronym being translated into nearly every single language on the planet, working to deceive, to sell a lie in which no one can be saved in. It is this very name, personification, and image that is the mark of the beast. So consider this for all those who have yet to come out of Babylon, those coming in the other names for the Messiah. These are lies. They're coming in the authority of the dragon to deceive, to work lawlessness. It doesn't matter if they have nearly every other thing in keeping the commands of Yahuwah correct, and even the Father's name. But if they're still partaking in false names for the Son, by character, they're denying the Son. Even if they're also using Yahushua, that would be lukewarmness. So beware these ministries, these people who are still mixing the pure, the clean, the kadosh, the awesome, the excellent of Yahuwah with the profane, the dirty, the disgusting, the abominable. Yahushua is not Jesus, and Jesus is not Yahushua. Yahushua is the Messiah. Jesus, Yeshua, Yahshua, Yahusha. These are lies. These are imposters. Yeshu, Jizu. They are false ways to the Father. They cannot enter the kingdom. They cannot be saved through the false names, through the lies. For those lies are the authority of the dragon. They are working for the spirit of anti-Mashiach. Of course, just as we were saved by the name of Yahushua, any one of these people, according to the will of Yahuwah, can, and Yahuwah willing shall, repent of lukewarmness, of Babylonian spiritual mindset, of working lawlessness. I encourage you to reach out to them with the truth, with Yahushua and the Ruach of Yahuwah. Hallelujah. Yahuwah Al Shaddai, Barak you, as you go forth and fight the good fight, the tube fight of Amunah. Hallelujah.
Baruch Hashem Yahuwah.